welcome to First Missionary Baptist Church. My name is Pastor Calvin Smith. I want to thank you for allowing us to share this Sunday morning with you.
It says when two or three are gathered together in his name, that he will be in the midst of us. And I don't know about you, but I feel his presence on today. Amen, amen. We do once again honor you for being here this morning. We want to welcome our online viewers this morning. Thank you for carving out time out of your schedule to be a part of this worship experience at First Missionary Baptist Church. So at this time now, we shall prepare our hearts to receive our morning announcements. Amen.
Good morning, members, guests, partners, and friends, and welcome to First Missionary Baptist Church, where we are empowering believers to expand God's kingdom. And thank you for watching and listening to this week's upcoming events and announcements. FMBC would like to wish a happy birthday to all members and guests who are celebrating their special day on today or this week. If that is you, please stand at this time so we can recognize you. And if you are watching us via Facebook Live or YouTube, please put it in the chat that today is your birthday so we can recognize you. Happy birthday, and may God bless you with many, many more from the FMBC family. Today is Communion Sunday, in remembrance of the body and blood of Jesus that was sacrificed, broken, and poured at the cross for us. For our online viewers, please make sure you have communion ornaments ready, such as water, juice, and crackers or bread, so that you can partake in communion during service along with us. Our Community Fun Day is quickly approaching, and remember, we will be hosting this event on Saturday, September 16th from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Let's get the word out and let's tell our community what we are doing. So please make sure that you go to our Facebook page and share the Community Fun Day post on your Facebook page. And also, members, you have received an email with the flyer attached. So please make sure that you are sending that flyer to all your social media outlets, as well as sending that to your friends and family in the Thomasville community. Please also note that we do have flyers available at church if you would like to take those and post them to the areas where kids frequent in Thomasville. Also, all members who will be participating and working in the FMBC Community Fun Day, we will have a meeting on next Sunday, September 10th, immediately after service to tie up any loose ends and to give you your assignment for that day. So get excited, be in prayer, because FMBC will have our Community Fun Day on Saturday, September 16th. We will have a new members class on Saturday, September 30th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. This class will be for all new members who have recently joined FMBC, any member who has never been through a new members class, and also anyone who would just like to learn more information about First Missionary Baptist Church. Lunch will be provided, and you will need to see Lady Tanya if you are planning to attend. FMBC, we are blessed to be a blessing. And what a privilege and honor it is to give unto God our tithes, offerings, and gifts of love. There are four ways that you can give unto our ministry. You can give in person during our 10:45 a.m. worship service. You can use the Giftify app or Givelify website and give online or your mobile device, search First Missionary Baptist Church when you use Givelify, or you can mail in your tithes and offerings. Remember, God is our source, and we give with a cheerful heart. At this time, we ask that all of you please silence your cell phone or any electronic device that you have with you on today. Remember that there is no food or drink in the sanctuary, and please limit any unnecessary movements as the word goes forth on today. This concludes our announcements and upcoming events for this week. We are First Missionary Baptist Church, and our leaders are Pastor Calvin and Lady Tanya Smith. We are located in the beautiful city of Thomasville at 103 Church Street, and you can contact us at 336-475-9632. Thank you for your continued support and generosity to our ministry. And remember, at FMBC, we are empowering believers to expand God's kingdom. Stay in the blessing.
Amen. We thank God for all of those announcements. And I do need to, before we do the tithes and offerings, Pastor, I failed to get an announcement to our secretary. Is it possible I can make this announcement? I like to do things decently in order. Amen. I just want to remind the ladies that we will be having our women's ministry this coming Saturday. And we did change the time a little bit from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. this time. We're going to rotate the time so it can allow those who are not able to make a morning session to be able to come in the afternoon. So I look forward to seeing you on next Saturday here at First Missionary at 2 p.m. And we're going to talk about some strongholds. Amen. So just get your hearts and mind prepared, and we'll see you next Saturday. All right. Well, it's offering time. Amen. Y'all, oh, wait a minute. Y'all a little weak about that. It's offering time. Amen. Amen. You should always be enthusiastic about your offering. And what Minister Sinclair, you always say about our offering? There you go. So we're going to sow our seed with some purpose in mind. Amen. We're going to sow our seed with some expectation. Amen. Amen. So if we would get our offertory confession and you're able, please rise to your feet. Amen. Let us begin. Lord, I thank you for blessing me with this opportunity to worship you with my tithes and offerings. It is a privilege to give my talents, gifts, and my resources to First Missionary Baptist Church to empower our believers and to present the gospel to this community. We sow this seed into this ministry, being obedient to your word. You said that if I give, it shall be given back to me, good measure, pressed down, and shaken together. Lord, I thank you that I don't lack for anything, and that you are able to make all grace, every favor, and earthly blessing come to me in abundance, so that I am always and in all circumstances furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 We certainly want to thank you for your giving, and we declare and decree that God will multiply your seed. Amen. At this time, we want to pause in our worship service to recognize any visitors, any first-time visitors, either in our congregation or online. If this is your first time visiting with us online, please put it in the chat. Someone will reach out to you. And if in our sanctuary, if it's anyone, it's their first-time visitors, please just raise your hand up in the air. Amen, amen. Well, we certainly want to thank you once again, and we welcome you on this morning. Well, I'm going to move on out the way because I know you as well as I is ready for the word. Amen, amen. So we're going to get ready, prepare our hearts to receive a dynamic word from our pastor. So won't you just stand up and give God an offering praise for Pastor Calvin Smith.
Come on and give God some praise in the house. Thank you so much. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Give God some praise. Hallelujah. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord once again. And so we are delighted. One of the writers said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go unto the house of the Lord. You know, it doesn't matter sometimes the difficulty we have during the week, but if I can just make it to the Lord's house, if I could just get in the presence of God's people, saturate myself with prayer and praise and worship, it just seems like to me everything kind of works itself out for that moment. Amen? So we are so grateful for that. I know that we have had our announcements, but I do want to reiterate just a few of the announcements. If you would go on our church's Facebook page, you would see, you could be seated. You will see the flyer for September the 16th. Listen, I gotta ask. I want you, I encourage you, I need you, I employ you to put this on your social media page, especially to those persons who are located in the Thomasville, Lexington, and High Point area. We want to saturate the community. We want to invite the community out to come and have a fun fellowship and a fun day with us. And this is our way of extending the kingdom of God into the community. So we need your help to get this word out. We only got 2 weeks to get the word out. So I'm asking today, I'm not going to ask you to do it right. I started to ask y'all to go on y'all's phone right now and do it. But I'm not going to do that. But I do ask you today, please pull the flyer off of the church's Facebook page. Send that flyer out. And also, I think that our administrator had sent also some flyers to your personal addresses. Just send those out. We need your help. We want to be sure that we can minister to as many young people as we can. Now, let me say, because I'm on the air, now this is restricted in such a, in a sense that we're actually looking to minister to those kids 2-3 years up to 12 years of age. So those are the age group. I'm sorry, maybe next year we'll do something for the teenagers, but we have limited to that age group. And let me also say, this is not a place where you're going to have the opportunity to drop your kids off and leave. All right? So we want parents to come. They got to sign their kids in to get a bracelet to be able to participate. But again, this is not an event or ministry where you just come, drop your kids off and leave and that type of thing. So that is not how we're going to approach it. The second announcement that I do want to make is I'm starting Bible study again. Let me first of all, can y'all give all of my ministers a big God bless you? They had done all of the Bible study for me in the month of August, and I'm just so appreciative because it gave me a little bit of break that I could take a breather and kind of get focused back on what the Lord has said. I'm just so glad to have some help, y'all. And so I'm real thankful for all of my ministers. This week, I'm going to begin to start teaching on I Am a Church Member. This was a book that we had asked our membership to consider and read because we want everybody on the same page. But even if you didn't read it, we're going to start my Bible study on this week. We're going to pull some things out of this book that I think are vital to us as a body of Christ so we can move forward as a unified body in Christ. Amen. So I will be teaching on this I Am a Church Member by Tom Rainer. I'll start this teaching on this Wednesday evening. Amen. All right. Listen, I want you to consider with me, if you will just rest back on your feet one more time. I want you to consider with me 1 Corinthians. This is the Lord's Supper Day. So I wanted to do something in regards to that. And so I'm going to do 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. And I'm just going to only read two verses out of that passage of scripture. And we're going to just see what the Holy Spirit is going to say to us in regards to this passage of scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter number 11, verse number 24 through 26 says this: "And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, excuse me, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death." And some translations say you do proclaim the Lord's death till he come. I want to lift out this passage of scripture in verse number 25 when it says, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And simply, I just want to just tag this text this morning and say a call to remember. A call to remember. Father, we just thank you, God, for this privilege to stand before these, your sons and daughters. We invite and invoke the Holy Spirit to come and to minister to us in the way that he sees that we stand in lead of today. Father, I pray, God, now that you will sanctify me, set me apart for the use of your service once again. Holy Spirit, give me the power, enable me to be able to proclaim this gospel in such a way that everybody will be able to receive it. Thank you, God, as your word go forth, it will not come back void, but it will accomplish that as which you have set it out to do and to please you. God, we thank you for what you're getting ready to do in the midst of your people today. In Jesus' name, let every heart shout, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Now listen, before I get into this word today, I'm going to do something different. How many of y'all know that that I'll change up in just a heartbeat? Amen. We got a woman of God that has been a part of this ministry for so many years, and you know, because of COVID and because of how things had transpired, we haven't heard her voice in a long time. And I'm just so excited to be able to hear her voice once again. And I'm going to ask Tony if she would come and just give us a selection right before. Come on, y'all welcome her. Y'all welcome her. Come on and put your hands together and welcome her as she comes and render a solo for us today. Amen. Praise God.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. God has been good to me, and I know he's been good to y'all. And I don't know what to say. But I thank God. I thank God for the gift. You know, it's been hard. But you know what? Pastor said to me, he said, it's time to be poured into. When you pour out so much, it's time for you to be poured into. And when he said that, I listened every Sunday to the word, and it started really, it was like I was getting it. Man. I was getting it. And sometimes when you have an agenda and you just come to church, and you do your duty, then you don't really listen to what's going on. Right. And I thank God that I had to sit and listen. I thank God because it encouraged my walk with God. I'm just going to do a little bit of this. It is Communion Sunday, and I hope it blesses you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. the blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power.
I know that God's blood will never lose its power. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Tony, for that ministry today. We're just so excited about that. You're reminding us about the celebration that we're having today. Thank you for reminding us that no matter what you're going through in life, his blood never loses its power. Amen. So we're thankful for that. A call to remember. How many of y'all know that I just celebrated a birthday? Yes. Amen. Celebrated a birthday, but even before my birthday, I began to start noticing something, Deacon Dalton. And what I began to start noticing about me is that my priorities, even before my birthday, began to start shifting. Those things that meant a lot to me as I was coming up, it seems as though that it's losing its value now. Those things that were significant to me, those things that I focused on, those things that I prioritized and placed them at the highest level of my calendar, those things now begin to start being less valuable as I get a little bit more mature. My interests and hobbies have changed. I used to love playing golf, still love playing golf, but I know I cannot walk 18 holes no more. So I'm looking forward to finding a new hobby, and I think I found one. It's called fishing. Amen. It don't take a whole lot of energy to do that. And I think I'm going to choose that as a hobby. Amen. But what I found out was is that, and things are changing, and my focus has begun to start changing, y'all. And so now when I go work out, see, I see y'all's faces out there. When I go work out, I don't go work out now to go get buffed. Amen. I don't go work out, y'all, to get some kind of a six-pack. The reason why I'm going to work out is I need to do cardiovascular to keep my heart strong. Things have begun to start changing. And as they are beginning to start changing, what I'm realizing is that it's more prevalent to me when I ask the question, how can I make an impact on the lives of others? That's where my focus is now, is that how can I create memories for my wife that she will forever hold on to? How can I create those memories for my children? How can I impact their lives in such a way that when I'm gone, they'll be able to pull back a memory and remember something good about their dad or their grandfather? What legacy? That's where I'm at, Brother Jackson. I'm trying to figure out, and my concentration now is, what legacy do I want to leave behind me? I know that on a headstone, they got the birth date and the end date, the date that you expire. But up above that, it always gives a description of who you are. What is going to be placed on my headstone? That's what my concern is now, is what will they say about me? I know some of y'all don't have that problem because you figure, you know, I don't care what nobody says about me. That may be your attitude, but as I get older, I'm trying to figure out, you know, what is people going to say? What are they going to say about me when they stand up at my funeral? What impact have I made? What are my friends and my families are going to say? Will they recall a moment of my grandchildren when I caused them to smile? Will they be able to reflect on something that I said that will give them hope when they're struggling in the midst of a situation? What will I be remembered for in FMBC? What will FMBC be remembered for in the community? I've often shared with us and said that it will be a sad day that if we close the doors of this church and the community don't even realize that we're gone. What impact as we, as the body of Christ, are making in this community? Maya Angelou once said, and I think she said it very well, she says this, and I quote, "People don't remember what you said or did. They remember how you made them feel." What impact are we doing in our lives now that will cause people to remember who you are? When I started thinking about this, Tony, I'm reminded of a story when Jesus found himself in Bethany. Jesus was there. And this woman was there. He was eating dinner at Simon the leper's house. When a woman came to him with an alabaster box full of precious ointments, she poured the oil on Jesus' head as he sat and ate. His disciples were upset when they saw this happening because they thought that what she was doing was wasteful. But Jesus said something about this lady that kind of brought back to my remembrance. Jesus said this. He says, "Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel is preached throughout the whole world, this also that she have done shall be spoken of a memorial of her." And here we are, over 2,000 years later, because of the impact that she made upon Jesus on that day, we're able to pull from Scripture and use her as an example. I don't know how this woman's story revealed. I don't know what happened to her in that moment to make her take all of the precious ointment that she had and sprinkle it on Jesus' head and wipe the tears off of his feet. I don't know, Shirlene, what was going on in her psyche when she barged in a dinner that she wasn't invited to come in just to be in the presence of God. And she anointed the head of Jesus. Sometimes, Micah, I wonder when she poured that anointment upon Jesus, you all realized the next day that he was going to be hanging on a cross. And in my spiritual mind, I can imagine as Jesus hung on the cross between humanity and divinity, he smelled the fragrance of the oil. And as he smelled the fragrance of the oil, he remembered the worship and the sacrifice and the service that she offered him the day before. What will we be remembered for? What memories are we creating that will impact the lives of the people that we love? Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. Jesus said this because Jesus created such an impact on society that even today we're pausing from our busy schedule. We are reflecting upon and remembering upon the sacrifice and the service and the suffering that Jesus Christ did to free us from the debt of sin. We are to remember. The Bible speaks a lot about remembering. I remember when God told the Israelites, he said, don't you remember how I opened up the Red Sea and how I fed you with manna in the wilderness? That's amazing to me because God has given them a point of reference to say that if I did it then I can do it again. And I know I'm preaching to somebody this morning because I need to remind you that the same God who brought you out, the same God who healed you, the same God who delivered you, he said, I can do it again. Sometimes, it may not be you, but sometimes I can see God's hand moving, and yet when an obstacle come my way, I doubt God. And God said, did I not open the Red Sea? Did I not feed you with manna from heaven? Remember Christ. The Bible talked about how Joshua, in Joshua chapter 4, verse 9, God told Joshua, he said, take 12 stones. That's symbolic of the 12 tribes of Israel. And those 12 stones was put in the Jordan River where the feet of the priests rested upon to bring the presence of the God into the promised land. And God told Joshua, I want you to put up those 12 stones as a memorial. To help people remember, and not only help them remember, but help the generation that come after them remember what I've done for my people. The psalmist says, in Psalm 17:11 says, remember the works of the Lord. We should remember. Can I make just several observations of why we should remember? Number one is, we need to remember so that we won't forget the things that God has done for us. But because if we don't remember, then we will become ungrateful and unthankful. We got to remember what God has done, because that is one of the great devices of the enemy, is that when God has done so much for us, as Michael has shared this morning in prayer, that sometimes we have a tendency to forget what God has done, and we don't be thankful. The Bible declares, he said, if you be faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many, which gives us the understanding, if I can be thankful just because I can breathe, I'm thankful. Just because I got clarity of mind, I'm thankful. Just because I got activities of the use of my limbs, I'm thankful. Just because I can see, I can touch, I can feel, I don't know about y'all, have I got any thankful people in the house? Thankful. I remember Lady Tan when I had the heart attack in 2015, and I come out and I was recovering, and I couldn't take a shower for 5 or 7 days because I couldn't walk no further from here to that speaker because I was just out of breath. When I was able to take my first shower, I was thankful over the small things. And I believe that when we are thankful over the small things, that God will, it gives God permission to release some other things in your life. Being thankful. When I'm talking about being thankful, I think of the 10 lepers who were sitting outside of the city that day, and they were isolated from the activities of the whole world. They were isolated in one spot. And as Jesus walked by, they said, "Lord, have mercy upon me." Have anybody ever cried that prayer? Have anybody ever prayed that prayer? Lord, help. Didn't have a whole lot of words to say. Didn't need to use a long vernacular. Just, "Lord, have mercy on me." Jesus heard their prayer that day, and the Bible says that when Jesus heard their prayer, he says, he told them, he said, "Go show yourself to the priest." All 10 acted in faith. They began to start walking to the temple, and in the midst of their walking to the temple, they become healed from the disease of leprosy. The Bible says that out of the 10, only one returned to be thankful. See, I'm just so amazed how God can do a supernatural thing in our life. And we want it for that moment, but all of a sudden, we'll forget what God has done for us. We needed our bodies touching. We were crying out like the lepers, "Lord, have mercy upon me." And when God met that need, we did like the other 9. We kept going about the business of our lives. We went back to our families, and we went back to our businesses, and we went back to doing things as we normally would do, and we failed to tell the Lord, "Thank you." The second thing I think that remembering does is to help us to get through difficult times. When you are able to remember how God brought you out, when you are able to remember how God had healed you and delivered you, it gives you hope that he will and can do it again. I think the third thing that remembering does, it offers us solutions to current problems. If we're able to reflect back onto what has transpired in the past and use that information, not to use it as something to beat yourself up or to stay there or feel guilt or shame, but to use the information of failure to become a success. The past can offer us the current solutions to problems that we're facing now. And fourthly, a remembering can help us to hold on to something special. Things that we don't want to forget. The impact that folk have had on our lives. And maybe that's why I'm preaching this sermon this morning, because out of everything else, the most that I can leave my wife, the most that I can leave my children and my grandchildren is a memory. Because one day I won't be tangible. One day they can't touch me. And if somehow or another I can impact them in such a way that in those moments of darkness, in those moments of being alone, they can think about a memory that we created for them. Lastly, I believe that when we remember, we really begin to appreciate how far we come when we're able to remember. Jesus' death had an impact on the world. This is why Jesus said, "As often as you do this in remembrance of me," because he impacted the world. But the prophet Isaiah had already prophesied that this was going to happen. Y'all remember in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, it says this, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes I'm healed. It was prophesied that Jesus was going to live, that he was going to die, that he was going to be buried. But on the third day, God raised him up from the dead. Jesus' death impacted history. It changed the cross from a tragedy to triumph. This was the most powerful divine event in the history of creation. And it ushered in a new age when Jesus said, it's expedient for me to go, because had I not go, then I cannot send forth the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit. Because of this tremendous event in history, the Holy Spirit does not just rest on us. The Holy Spirit just do not enable us to accomplish a work or an assignment. But the Holy Spirit dwells on the inside of us to work in us and through us to accomplish what God has predestined for our lives. I'm reminded, y'all, of what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. And I just want to remind you of it. When Paul says, know you not that you are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. If you don't hear anything that I can say today, please hear the fact that the person of God, the person of the Holy Spirit, lives on the inside of you. If any man, Paul says, defile the temple of God, he shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy. And then he asks this profound question that all of us got to wrestle with, is which temple are you? We have the most important person in the world living on the inside of us. The president is not the most important person in the world. The House and the representatives are not the most important person in the world. The most important person in the world is the Holy Ghost that lives on the inside of you. And I'm glad about it today. Y'all know why I'm glad. Because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that is in us. No Christian should ever say, I can't. No Christian should ever limit themselves or box themselves in or give themselves boundaries, because the word of God in Philippians 4:19 says, I can do, y'all ain't praying with me today. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. We should never say what we can't do or what we limit to. Oh, we should never allow people to put limitations on the God that lives on the inside of us. This communion, this remembrance of Christ, this remembrance of the Lord's Supper, which is called communion. In the Greek, the word is communio. It means fellowship. And one of the other meanings of the word community is Eucharist, which is an act of thanksgiving. And Jesus introduced this communion in the Gospels. And Paul picks it up in this passage, this targeted scripture that I had read. Communion then is a fellowship, but it's deeper than that, y'all. And the reason why it's deeper, it's not only just a fellowship between us and the Lord, but it's a fellowship between you and I as common believers. Signifying that we believe in the same thing. We may differ on a lot of things, but this one thing that we should be on one accord is, and that Jesus lived, he died, he was buried, and on the third day, God resurrected him. And now he sits on the right hand of the Father. interceding for you and I. This fellowship is bringing us together to share in the same belief. I want to make two observations, if I could. One observation is, let me say this, is you don't need to come to church to take communion. Now, I'm gonna kill some calves. Amen. You know, see, we worried about whether the deacons got on white gloves or they don't have on white gloves. We're worried about whether we're serving wine or whether we're serving juice. And if we got caught up on those things, we have totally missed the meaning of communion. And so my point being is you don't have to wait to come to church to take communion. Listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to his... Now, let me go back. In 1 Corinthians 11, 26 says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, he said, all I want you to do is just remember me. Can I tell you something? You can take communion at home. You don't need no pastor to give it to you. You don't need no deacon to give it to you. You don't need no deaconess to give it to you. You can have it Monday through Saturday, Monday through Friday. You can have it as many times as you want to in your own home. I heard of pastors who are refusing to commune God's people. How dare them to make a decision on whether or not I partake of the Lord's body or not. It's not their choice. The Bible says, as often as I do this, as long as I do this in remembrance of him, then I'm able to take communion. Nobody can resist me or deny me the opportunity to eat the Lord. I know that it may be going against the grain with some people. But this is what the Bible says. Can I tell you the second thing is that I want to clarify? When we say that we are partaking of the communion unworthily, many believers believe that when they look at unworthiness, they say, well, you know, I sin. I've fallen short of the glory of God. I'm unworthy to take communion. And let me just say, if that's the criteria, none of us will take communion. Because the Bible says all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So if that's your measuring of whether or not you take communion or not, I think that you're using the wrong standard. But when Paul said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 29, can I read it for you again? He says this, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Let me help us to understand what is happening, because Paul is dealing with a Corinthian church that got a whole lot of stuff going on. There's division in the church because there were some folk who were the haves, and then there were some who were the have-nots. Well, the haves was bringing in a feast, and they were separating themselves, and all of them were eating and drinking and being joyful. But then you had another group over here that didn't have anything to eat. They didn't have anything to participate in. So in essence, what they were doing, they were going against the foundation of what communion is really about. Communion is about community. Amen. It's about unity. Yeah. It's about love. And because of their acts, Paul said, you are unworthy. Why? Because you are causing a division in the church. It wasn't because I'm not worthy to take communion. It's because the fact is that I was causing division in the church. And then when he says, because you are not discerning the Lord's body. It wasn't the Lord's body that they were not discerning. It was discerning the body of Christ. That you have sowed a seed of division in the body of Christ using the very vehicle that I want to institute to bring people together. Give God a praise offering. And so he said that we were not discerning the God's body. Let me say this. So when we're eating and drinking unworthily, he's saying that we're causing division in the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to look at several reasons real quickly what we should remember. I think the first thing that we should remember, write it down, lend it to your mind. The first thing that we should remember his suffering. I'm going to say that again, because I think sometimes we forget about the suffering servant. What it cost Jesus to pay the price for the penalty of our sin. Moses could not do it. He was a great man. Abraham could not do it. Gideon could not do it. David was a great king, but David could not do it. It was only the Lamb of God. John looked out one day and saw Jesus walking. He said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who take away the sins of the world." He was the suffering servant. I like how the Hebrew writer put it. He puts it like this, Hebrew 12, chapter 2. Write it down. It's very important. This is what he says. He says, "Looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him." Wait a minute now. I got a problem with the text. The problem that I have with the text is that he said that it was for the joy that was set. How could that be joy? How could putting a crown of thorns on your head and making you bleed become joy? How could it be that you nailed his hands and his feet to the cross and he still counted it joy? And can I tell y'all the reason why Jesus could count it joy? Because he said he counted it joy. He endured the cross. Why? Because of you and I. Because he was the only candidate worthy to take away the sins of the world. This is what we're celebrating today, is the suffering servant, the one who gave his life so whereby that you and I could be able to live. I think not only do we need to look at the suffering and the sacrifice of the cross, I think that we also need to consider the resurrection of the cross. Because in this setting of remembering Christ, remembering his grace and remembering his love, had he not got up, he would have been just a man. He would have been like Muhammad or Buddha or those others, because they died and never come back. But because Jesus rose from the dead, we got to remember that. We can remember the suffering servant, but if we fail to remember that on the third day, he got up with all power in his hand. And when he got up, Elder Jackson, he gave us victory over life. He gave us victory over the death and the grave. We no longer have to fear death anymore because of the resurrection power of Jesus. I thank God for the resurrection, because it's because of the resurrection that Jesus now say, it's expedient for me to go, because I'm going to give you another comforter. I'm not going to give you one of the another kind. I'm going to give you somebody just like me. But it was only because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is only through the resurrection and our belief and faith in the resurrection that now we can be saved, and you and I can have the right to eternal life. I think that's worth remembering. I think that it's worth remembering the purpose of his suffering. There was a penalty that had to be paid, that no one could satisfy the debt of what needed to be paid. But Jesus Christ volunteered to come down, and God in his majesty, in John 1 said, the word become flesh and dwelt among us. He dwelt among us because he understood the purpose. And in my mind, Shirley, and goes back to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he's now hanging in the balance between humanity and divinity. And his flesh said, Lord, please take this cup from me. But his purpose says, let not my will be done, but let your will be done. There was a purpose in his suffering. Can I give you just one more thing to remember? You got to remember that we now are in the New Testament. The Word of God says, he says, this blood is symbolic of the New Testament. The word testament actually means covenant. So what the writer is saying, that you and I now live under a new covenant. That's something to remember, that we don't have to adhere and follow the mandates and the laws of the Mosaic law. God has given us his grace. Where before, God wrote his law upon a tablet of stone. And when Moses come out the mountain, he broke the stone because of the idolatry that he saw in the life of Israel. And God had to go back, but God did not write the stone this time with his finger. Moses wrote it himself. But now, according to Hebrews, but now have he obtained a more excellent ministry. But how much also he is a mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if the first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for a second covenant. But God, in his grace, in his mercy, in his sacrifice, and in his service, ushered in by his blood a new covenant. But Romans chapter 6 verse 1 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin, knowing that grace abound? God forbid. So what Paul is saying, because we're operating in grace, we can never afford to take grace for granted, because we're living under the grace. I think something else, and I've hit on it pretty good, so I'm not going to stay on it long. But I think something else that we need to remember, if you don't hear anything else, is that we got to remember who's on the inside of you. That's why Paul said, greater is he that is in me. Paul wasn't looking on his own affairs, but Paul realized and understood that there was a person of Jesus Christ living on the inside of him. That's why Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it's the Christ who lives in me. And the faith that I now live in the flesh, I live by the love of Jesus Christ who loved me. Paul is saying, my life is not my own. He's saying, I'm allowing the person of Jesus Christ to dictate my life. Wherever the Holy Spirit goes, I go. Whatever he says, I say. My body is crucified, and I'm just following the person that's on the inside of me. If we ever get this truth, if we ever understand that God has equipped you with everything that you need in the person and the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you two more. Can I give you two more right quick? The last one is, we need to remember we have victory, y'all. We should not live a life of defeat. No matter what trials, no matter what challenges, no matter what mountains that come your way, life shows up sometime. But we should have a different perspective on life. James says that the trying of your faith work patience. And James said, count it all joy. What do you mean, James, count it all joy when my finances look crazy and my marriage is on the rocks and my health is fading? James said, count it all joy. Why? Because God got a use just for that. And when we realize, Tony, that everything that we go through, God don't waste nothing, that he will turn things around that was meant for your evil. He'll turn, I know I got one or two people. If there are one or two people in here that can testify that God turned some stuff around in your life, had it not been for the goodness of Jesus. I said he turned some stuff. He was behind the scenes, y'all. And that's why I gotta thank him, because not thanking him for what I've seen, but I'm gonna thank him for the stuff that I did not see that he saved me from. It's the Holy Spirit. And we got to understand that we work not for victory. We work from the place of victory. Why? Because Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33, he said, these things, listen to what he said, I have spoken unto you that ye might have peace. Are you in peace? We ought to have peace. I don't care what's going on. Because the enemy gets us so caught up looking at the natural, we forget to look at the unseen. Because Paul said, the natural things are just temporary, but the things which are unseen are eternal in God. The things I'm fighting from victory, not a place of defeat. I'm tired of hearing Christians talking about how they are defeated in the Lord. How can you be defeated when Jesus Christ have already overcome every burden, every trial, every challenge, every disease? Jesus has already overcome it for us all. But we got to receive it. And we got to believe it. Somebody said, Jesus said it, I believe it, and that settles it. Then lastly, we got to remember that Jesus is coming back, y'all. I said, Jesus is, no man know the time or the hour that the Son of Man shall come. But Jesus is coming back. Watch what he says in it. He says, listen, he says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death until he comes, which tells me, Deacon Dalton, that he's coming back. Now, we can have a theological debate whether it's going to be pre-trib or tri-trib or any of those things. We can have that conversation. But the conversation that I would like to have with you this morning, whether it's pre or whatever, post, are you ready? That's the question that we have to settle, not whether it's pre or post-resurrection, but are we ready when Jesus comes? I'm closing on this last thought, y'all, and it's coming out of verse number 26. We got to remember to proclaim Christ. Listen, the word proclaim means to stand up and make a big audience of. Let me see. The word proclaim, Walter, really gives us an idea of you're standing up and you are boasting about something. You are making a proclamation about something. Can I say something to us saints? Everybody else is coming out the closet. Why come we can't? They got us so locked down that we scared to mention Jesus. They got us so locked down that we're afraid to proclaim Christ, not only in our words, but also in our actions. But the Bible says that as often as you drink this cup and eat this blood, drink this blood, he said, until he comes back, he said, make a proclamation. Everybody need to proclaim something about the goodness of Jesus. You may say, Pastor, well, I'm not good at evangelism. And I don't know how to lead nobody to Christ. But I think everybody in here got a testimony. I said everybody in here got a testimony. If I had to raise your hands, I don't think there would not be not one hand in here this morning that could not testify of the goodness of Jesus Christ. And that's what proclamation, family of God, is all about. It's telling somebody about the goodness of Jesus Christ. I don't know about y'all, but when I look back over my life and I consider where God has brought me from, I got to give God the praise and the glory, because I didn't get here on my own. Had it not been for the grace and mercy of God, I don't know where I would be. The songwriter Walter said it all. Walter liked the saying, we're going to get him the note, find this song. The songwriter says this, or William Cooper says, there's a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and the sinner's plunged beneath that flood. Lose all his guilt and stain. Lose all his guilt and stain. This is what the blood of Jesus has done for us. We're no longer condemned. We're no longer held guilty for the penalty of sin. The blood of Jesus has cleansed us from all unrighteousness. But then I look at it, Michael, and I look at it and I say, well, the Eucharist is an act of thanksgiving. When we're coming to the table, how dare us not be thankful for what God has done? Any time that we come to this table, we ought to be humbling ourselves. We ought to get a new insight of ourselves. And the Bible says that when we come to this table, we ought to examine ourselves. We good at examining other people. But the Bible says that watch this. One writer said this, and I think it's so. He said, a life that is not examined is a life not worth living. We have to examine ourselves when he comes to this table. I don't know what you guys can remember today, but I got a whole lot of things to be thankful for and remember Christ for today. I had not been saved all my life. But even if I was saved, David says, I was born in iniquity and my mother conceived me in sin. Which means, y'all, that it don't make no difference how good you are. Watch this. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The sin is not your problem. Let me go over this side over here. Sin is not your problem. You say, well, Pastor, why you say that? Because sin already been taken care of. The problem is when you reject the one who has made it possible for you to have a relationship with Christ. I'm going to close now, and I just want to if Tom Ron would just give me a little soft music. I don't know who's in here today. I don't know what you have gone through. I don't know what you've been through or going through or will go through. But I just wanted to just remind us about how we live our lives today. Because how we live our lives today is going to impact the people that we love the most that's around us. Can we, like Jesus, say, do this in remembrance of me? Can we honestly say that what we're doing can impact the lives of others? I had the opportunity to visit a saint the other day, and I hope she don't mind me sharing. I'm not going to share the name. Powerful woman of God. When you think of this woman, the only thing you think about is that she's so steeped in the Word of God. And you know what she told me and Tan? She told us, she says, I keep a diary of my prayers. And she said, I hope one day that when I'm gone, that my children will take this prayer diary, and I hope that it will make an impact on their life. Of all the gifts that we could give our children or our grandchildren, she gave them the gift of prayer out of all those years. How are we impacting the people that surround us? We got to be careful how we treat people, because the communion table is about fellowship. It's about how we get along with one another. If we don't need nothing else right now, can I just say one thing? We need to start loving one another. Because the Bible says, he said, that's the only way that the world is going to be able to identify that we are Jesus' disciples, is that we love one another. And yet we have allowed the enemy to cause a seed of division even in the church as we partake of the Lord's Supper today. We're going to take just a few moments and we're going to examine ourselves. Not examining yourself to see whether or not you're worthy, but examining yourselves and ask the Holy Spirit, highlight those areas that's in my life that I need to confess as sin. Oh God, thank you, Jesus. Listen to me. I'm going to give you something real powerful. The Holy Spirit is giving you something real powerful. When we pray and we say, Lord, forgive us of my sins, that is not an adequate prayer. I'm going to say that again. Because, see, we ain't been taught. Well, Lord, forgive me for my sin. Which ones? Because, see, what happens is, if we don't confess that individual sin, then we're walking around with unconfessed sin. Y'all ain't with me. And I'm going to say it again because this is real powerful. Because some of us are in bondage because we're walking around with unconfessed sin. Because what we're telling God is, God, forgive me for my sin. No, forgive me the way that I talk to my wife. Forgive me from going off at the guy at McDonald's because he was on the phone. Forgive me for the waitress that I would have left a $20 tip for, I only gave it two because I was trying to make a point. It's the unconfessed sins that stops the Spirit flowing in our lives. So that's why it's important, y'all, as soon as you sin, go to the Holy Ghost. Lord, forgive me for this right here. And you do that throughout the day. And you will start seeing the Holy Spirit show up in your life in a way that you've never seen before. Because all your sins will be forgiven and confessed. He said, confess your sins one to another. That was for all of us. So I guess what I'm going to do now, I'm going to go to communion. Those of you who are able to take communion, and those of our partners who are online, we have a lot of partners that are online, we're going to take communion, then we're going to open the doors of the church. I want everybody to stand. And I want everybody that's taking communion, close your eyes. Take a minute just to look over the tapestry of your life. And if you got known sin in your life, I want you to confess it right now before the Lord. If you have known sin in your life, I shouldn't have said it that way. I shouldn't have behaved that way. I shouldn't have acted that way. I shouldn't have thought those thoughts that I had. Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for not being patient with others. Forgive me, oh God, that I receive your grace, but I'm not willing to extend your grace to somebody else. Forgive me of that person that's on my job that we fell out and I walk by them and they don't say nothing to me and I don't say nothing to them. And really, it's done got to the point where I don't care no more. Forgive me, God. Forgive me, God, that I made a quick judgment on somebody. And it was totally different than what I thought it was. Forgive me that I acted out of my emotions. Forgive me, dear God, because in my argument, I had to prove that I was right, even at the expense of hurting somebody. Let us take our bread. Let us break it. This is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was broken for you and for me. Let us eat it together. And as we're eating the body of the Lord, if there's any among you that are sick, I ask that you decree and declare that you are healed right now. According to 1 Peter 2:24, it says, by my stripes, you are already healed. And then he says, this is my blood of the New Testament. We no longer have to live under law. But now we have the opportunity of a new covenant where God now writes his laws upon our hearts, which means that now we can have a personal relationship with him. He says, drink this, drink ye all of this for the remission of whatever sin that you just confessed. Let us drink it together. And you have said about your partaking of the Lord's Supper that we intend to live a new life following the commandments of God. Somebody say amen. If you would be so kind now, I'm going to excuse our audience, our social audience. If you would excuse me, please turn in on Wednesday. We've got a dynamic Bible study for you. And we thank you for joining us today. And I hope that something was said or done will encourage you in your ministry today. Well, I have everybody. What an awesome word of the Lord. I hope it was inspiring to you. I hope it was challenging for you as you walk your Christian journey. And please join us again on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock and hope to be with you again on next Sunday morning.